Thank you, Amy. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, I invite you to open them to the fourth gospel, the Gospel of John. Some weeks ago, we began a brand new sermon series called Promises. We're learning that what God says is what God does, and what God does is based on what God has said. He's a promise maker God. He's a promise keeper God. Today we're looking at the Lord's promise of His return. The Lord's promise of His return. The 14th chapter of the Gospel of John. We'll begin reading with verse 1 through verse 6. Familiar verses, often read at funerals. But I'm telling you, these are verses not just for the dead, but for the living, for you and I today. Jesus speaking to the disciples then, speaking to the disciples now, let not your hearts be troubled, he says in John 14, beginning with verse 1. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms, many abiding places, many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, for I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. I will come again. Not I might come again, may come again, could come again. I will. Exclamation point. I will come again. And I will take you to myself that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going. Thomas, one of the disciples, said, Lord, we do not know where you're going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him this truth. I am God. I am the way. I am God. I am the truth. And I am God. I am the life. I am is the name that God gave Himself to Moses. And Jesus says, I am, because Jesus is God. No man comes to the Father except through me, says the Lord. We've been looking at the promises of God. And many of them have been encouraging and exhorting to each and every one of us. But I don't believe there's any promise found in the Bible that's more important, more relevant, more encouraging, more exhorting, any greater, any more needed, any more plentiful than the promise that Jesus made to His disciples then, and amens to us today, I am coming again. I am coming again. Someone who had some time on their hands, a theologian, went through Genesis all the way to Revelation. They looked at every chapter and every verse in every chapter of the 66 books in the Bible, and they determined that there's over 2,100 references to the coming of Jesus in the Scriptures in some way, shape, or form. 2,100 verses echoing amen, amen, amen to the promise that Jesus gave that He is coming again. If you go through all the verses that promise His return, we will find that His return is going to be a personal return. He's coming Himself. He's not sending a patriarch. He's not sending a prophet. He's not sending an apostle. He's not sending an early church father. He's not sending an angel. He's not sending an archangel. Jesus is coming Himself. And He's coming literal. Not only is His coming going to be personal, it's literal. It's not imaginative. It's not metaphorical. It's not illusionary. He's coming literally. He's also coming visibly. In the revelation phase of His return, every eye will see Him. And may I add, every knee will bend to Him. And every head will bow to Him. And every tongue will confess to Him, to the glory of the Father. What will they confess? He is Lord. I've said many times, we don't make Him Lord. We acknowledge His Lordship. He is Lord. His coming will be sudden, without warning. There'll be no announcements made. His coming will be imminent. Do you know it could happen at any moment? Pastor, what are we waiting on before Jesus can come? Nothing. The only reason He hasn't already come is because of His grace. His grace to unsaved people. It's not God's will that any should perish, but all come to life. Maybe He's waiting on you. That's how much He loves you. That's how gracious and merciful He is. Maybe He's just waiting on one of us here. His return will be victorious. His return will be victorious. He's going to vanquish the unholy trinity of Satan, the Antichrist, and the false prophet. He's going to destroy the new world order that they will establish. A one world government, a one world banking system, a one world religious system. And He will judge the wicked people who have rejected His offer of grace and mercy. And He will judge the fallen angels who chose to follow Satan and left Him. Ladies and gentlemen, He's coming again. Personally, literally, visibly, suddenly, imminently, victoriously. Get it down big, plain, and straight. The one who said, I go, is the one who says, I come. In fact, Revelation 22:20, the next to the last verse in the entire Bible, Jesus says again to you and I, yes, 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 yes. Yes, 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 I am coming again. Now, the promise of His coming is somewhat confusing to some of us, because we all can have various ideas and opinions and theories about how that coming is going to come about. And I respect that. But there is no guessing. There's no speculation. There's no doubt that He is coming again. We may not know all the details. We might not have the details right. But He is coming again. I like to look at it this way. I'm not on the planning committee. I'm on the welcoming committee. What God has planned in the return of His Son, I don't know. You don't know. If we do know, we only know in part. But we know He's coming. And we want to be there to welcome Him when He comes. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Now, there is a question that's often asked in regard to His return. In fact, probably the most asked question there is. When shall our Lord return? I get probably asked that question several times a week in regard to Bible prophecy. When shall our Lord return? And I got a good answer for it. I don't know. Now, if you ask me when I was 21, I know. 21-year-olds know everything, amen? But when you get close to 70, you don't know a whole lot. You get dumber as you get older. I know He's coming, but I don't know all the details of it, nor do I know the exact time of it. The Bible says we cannot know that. So if somebody tells you Jesus is coming next Wednesday at 10 o'clock, he told me so, they're lying to you, or they've been deceived. Nobody knows that day. Nobody knows that hour. But the Father and the Son do. He's coming again. But we can know the signs of it. We can know the season of it. We can know the proximity of it. Think with me. When we see grass turning green, when we see flowers blossoming, when we hear birds chirping, when we see the temperature rising, when we see the days getting longer and the nights getting shorter, we know that summer is near. We may not know the exact day and time that summer's coming, but we know it's coming. It's near. All the signs are there of the coming season. When you see a shadow of a person, you know that the real person behind that shadow is coming. That makes sense to you? If you see my shadow, I'm right behind my shadow. I might be a few inches, I might be a few feet, I might be a few yards. But when you see a shadow, you see the person coming behind it. When you see men being mobilized into the armed forces, when you see plants being converted to making weapons and ammunition, when you see ambassadors being called home from their places of representation, you know that war is coming. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, that's common sense. Well, Jesus said, common sense will tell you that when you see certain signs occurring increasingly, intensifyingly, one after another, you better look around. In fact, you better look up. Because I'm at the threshold of entering my return. What I'd like to do is give you three signs that I call the biggies. These come from Jesus himself. There's probably 250 to 300 signs that I could give you, but I know you want to be out by lunch. Not lunch next Wednesday, lunch today. So I'm just going to give you what I call the big three. In Matthew 24, Jesus was asked questions by the disciples about his return. Lord, we know you have promised to come again. Lord, can you tell us when that will be? And Jesus said, well, let me give you the proximity, the season, the signs to look for that will tell you I am coming even on my way. And so he began to preach to them a sermon called the Olivet Discourse. It's a sermon that really encompasses three chapters. And it talks about his return. And the first three signs that he gives to the disciples when he answered their question, I think are pertinent to us today. Those three signs deal with deception, death, and declaration, the three D's. If you have your Bibles, you might just want to flip over to Matthew 24. I don't want to spend a lot of time preaching through it. I've done that many times. But I just want to point out to you the three signs that Jesus said you really need to beware of. Because when I prepare to come, these signs are going to be very evident. They're going to be increasing. They're going to be intensifying. They're going to be piling up on each other, one after another, after another, after another, until I come again. So let's look at the first sign, verses 4 and 5, verse 11 of Matthew 24. If you got your Bibles, you can look at it. Jesus talks about one of the signs that his coming is near, the promise is about to be fulfilled, is global deception. The world is going to be deceived. Not just a country deceived, the entire world is going to be deceived. Now, who is the deceiver? Who is the liar? Who is the one who tries to use propaganda and ideology to corrupt the minds of men that he can lead men away from Jesus? He has a name. He's called who? The devil. Jesus said, in speaking of the devil, he said, I want you to never forget two things about him. He's a liar and he's a murderer. That's Jesus speaking, not me. I'm just amening what he said. Jesus said, Satan is a liar, he's a murderer, he's a deceiver, he's a destroyer. He lies to set you up to murder you, he deceives you to set you up to destroy you. Satan is a liar. There's no truth in him. And he wants to advance his new world order. He wants to become the God of this world. He wants this world to worship him. And he's moving full speed ahead to indoctrinate the minds of men with his deceptions. He's practicing deception in every area of life. And the deceptions that you and I are facing are the greatest since the beginning of time. They're coming fast and they're coming from a lot of directions. It's almost too much to absorb. We are being lied to at every single turn, setting us up for the big liar who's going to come and establish his new world order based upon lies. Politicians lie to us. That's a give me. Preachers lie to us. I can say that because I'm a preacher, and I'm telling you there's a lot of snakes in the grass that are in pulpits today who are poisoning their people that they claim to love with toxic deceptions. Bankers lie to us. Doctors lie to us. Lawyers lie to us. Salespeople lie to us. Judges lie to us. Educators lie to us. We used to put our trust in these kind of people because we always respected them and knew they would always tell us straight up the truth. You can't trust anybody anymore. They all have an agenda. They all have an ideology. They all have a propaganda motive. You can't trust them. Because we can't trust people because of deception, we're confused. We're looking for somebody that we believe will tell us the truth. Someone who can fix the mess that we see. And Satan has that man ready. His name's the Antichrist. But Jesus said in the last days, just before I come, you're going to see deception as never seen before, as Satan prepares the world for his greatest deceptions were yet to come. Then I want you to notice in verses 6 through 8, Jesus takes it from deception to death. He says, the world just before my promised return will not only be a place of deception where you're going to be lied to at every turn to set up the greatest liar in his kingdom that's built on deception. He said there's also going to be a culture of death. A culture of death. Everywhere you turn, there will be death. It was David who said in the Old Testament, we're but a step away from death. You think about that. All of us right here, right now, we're one step away from death. We live in a world of death. Life is cheap. Life is expendable. Our world has too many people, according to the experts. 50 to 75% of the world's population needs to be getting rid of. Our planet cannot sustain these people. We need to get rid of these people. And so the culture of death marches on to take the lives of people that our world believes aren't worthy to live. We disease the sickly so they'll die. We starve the hungry so they will die. Those little boys and girls we see on TV with their bellies bloated out and sores all over their body and people wanting money to try to feed them. I don't know if those wanting the money are legitimate. Listen to your pastor, but those pictures are legitimate. Those are real little boys and girls. And they're starving to death by the hundreds, the thousands, the tens of thousands, and the millions. As the haves get more and the have-nots get less. We use war to kill off civilians and combatants. We use suicide to get rid of the troubled. Our culture glorifies suicide. I promise you, those who take their life, 5 seconds after they do it, they wish they wouldn't have. If they think they got problems now, wait till then. We kill the innocent with criminals that we will not lock up. We're the age of psychopaths, serial killers, serial rapists. The day of the animals has begun. We kill the unborn with abortion. We commit genocide against the elderly and disabled because they have no more value to our system except to suck us financially dry, according to the officials. We kill the hurting by giving them drugs that we know good and well are going to take their life eventually. You see, we live in a culture of death, ladies and gentlemen. Everywhere you turn, somebody is dying, being put to death. It's just the way it is. And it's not getting any better. Jesus said, I've come that you might have life. He's come that you might have death. And he will kill you with his deceptions, his lies. And Jesus said, just before I come, the promise of my coming, you're going to see worldwide deception setting the world up for worldwide death. The book of Revelation says in the tribulation period, the last 7 years of history as we know it, one half of the world's population will be dead in less than 7 years. We lost 50 million people in World War II. If we lose half the world's population in 3.5 years, listen to your pastor, that's 3.5 billion people will die. As Satan and his new world dictator established their new world order. Then Jesus goes on and says there'll be one more thing. The gospel is going to be declared to every man, woman, teenager, and boy and girl. Verse 14. Before I come again. You see, the Lord loves people. And he wants to make sure that everybody has at least one chance. Many people will get multiple chances, but everybody's going to get one. And however he needs to do it, he's going to get the gospel out. The whole gospel to the whole world. Nobody is going to go without hearing it. He will use his evangelists like Scott Eady. He'll use churches like this church. He'll use missions programs like that missions program. He will use different people in different churches in different ways to propagate the gospel. He'll use Operation Christmas Child. He'll use all of that. But it's not going to be enough. the Great Commission is too much for the church anymore because many churches don't do it. Many pastors don't believe in it. And so God has another plan too. It's called divine intervention. God is going to raise up two of the greatest men that Israel has ever had in its history. Moses and Elijah are going to reappear in the city of Jerusalem. The great lawgiver, Moses, the great prophet, Elijah, they're going to go to Jerusalem and they're going to preach Christ crucified to the Jewish people and to the Jewish nation. And the Bible tells us that many Jewish people will come to know Jesus as their Savior. They've rejected Him up to then. They will receive Him then. And while that's going on, the Gentile nations are going to experience the greatest evangelist this world has ever seen. 144,000 Jewish men are going to be saved miraculously. A Damascus Road experience like Saul of Tarsus had before he became the Apostle Paul. 144,000 Jewish men will see a risen Christ. He'll speak to them. They'll get saved. They'll be given the gift of tongues. They'll spread across the planet. They'll preach Jesus. The greatest crusades this world has ever seen. And millions upon millions will bend their knee, bow their head, and confess Him as Lord. And then, before He comes, an angel will take up position in a pulpit right above this world. An angel who knows nothing about salvation because angels can't be saved. But this angel will be given the text and he will preach Jesus. The last message that will ever be preached about Jesus, this angel will preach it. And every single person in the world will hear it for the last time. And then Jesus will come again. So you see, in the worst of times, the deception and death, there's the best of times. Whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord can be saved. Our God is a very gracious God. I know some of you might be thinking to yourself, Pastor, that's fool's gold theology. I've been listening to preachers like you preach all my life. They've always said it. It's never happened. I think you got it wrong, Pastor. Bad thinking. Hasn't happened yet. Not going to happen. Let me look at here, me. If you think that this is fool's gold theology and you would dare utter it to somebody, you are fulfilling Bible prophecy. Because Peter, speaking on behalf of the Lord, said in his books that bear his name that in the last days mockers would come, smirkers will come, skeptics will come, scoffers will come, know-it-alls will come, full of baloney people will come, and they'll tell you He's not coming. May I say they're already here. But one day they'll see they were wrong. Hopefully not before it's too late. Because He said, I am coming again. In closing, if that be true, if that promise is going to happen, maybe happen in our lifetime, what should we be doing in preparation for the promise? What should we be doing? I'd like to propose to you three things and we're through. Number one, I'd get saved. Now, I believe in a congregation this size, a vast majority of you are saved. You have placed your faith in Christ and Christ alone. You've repented of your sin. You've been born again. There's evidences in your life. There's testimony in your life. There is facts in your life that would suggest that you have been saved. You're heaven born. You're heaven bound. I believe most of you are in that born again category. But I believe there's a few of you that right now, if Jesus was to come, you'd be left behind. And if you were to die, you wouldn't go to heaven. You're not saved. You're not saved because you put your faith in the wrong thing, or you haven't put your faith in the right thing. Some of you right now are trusting in philosophy to save your soul. You have a certain system of beliefs. Maybe you got them from somebody else. Maybe you thought them up yourself. And you've fallen into this idea that as long as you're sincere and you believe the right things sincerely, or even the wrong things sincerely, as long as you're sincere in your beliefs, everything will be okay. There is a way which seems right unto a man, says the Bible, but at the end is the way of death. You're not saved by philosophy. I don't care how sincere you may be. You're not saved by religion. Religion comes from the devil, who is a liar. The Bible teaches relationship with God through Jesus Christ. That's what the Bible teaches. You know God through Jesus. That's what John 14:6 is saying. But religion says, whatever in the name of the religion be, there's about 30,000 religions in the world probably. But religion says, just do this or just do that. Don't do this, don't do that. Religion says, just do the best you can. And in doing so, you're going to impress God so much that God's going to say, just come on into my heaven. He's going to let you bypass Jesus. You can go into heaven through the back door. You can climb in the side window. Because your ceremony, your creed, your code, your cause, your chant, your conduct is a choice that you can make without Jesus and still go to heaven. Religion comes from the devil. It confuses people. If I've heard it once, I've heard it 1,000 times. Pastor, I'm a Catholic. Who cares what you are? I'm a Baptist. Who cares what you are? Who cares what you are? You better be a born-again believer. I'm good. I've got good works. I'm benevolent. I'm a humanitarian. I'm sincere. Listen to your pastor. Look at me, please. If you're going to be saved, you've got to receive Jesus into your life. You've got to knowingly, willingly, wantingly do it. You can't have somebody twist your arm and make you do it. You can't cut a deal with God and do it. You can't do it accidentally. You know you're a sinner. You need a Savior. You take your sins to Him. You receive His salvation. He saves you. And your life is changed. Get saved. Get saved. Some of you right now, you know you're lost. But you're just too stubborn to admit it. You keep going back to what you did when you were 8 years old, or what you did when you were 19 years old, or what this one said, or what that one said. Get saved. Secondly, if we believe the promise is going to be fulfilled in our lifetime, and it is going to be fulfilled, we just don't know when. We need to encourage one another. Hebrews 10:25, do not forsake the assembling of thyselves together as the day approaches. What is the day he's talking about? The return of Jesus. We need each other. That's what the sermon series at night's about. It's called Engage. I need you. You need me. You need them. You need them. If there was ever a time we need to be coming together in a tight formation and marching in unison and in harmony, it's right now, ladies and gentlemen. And yet, what do we see? We see people laying out of church when the Bible says they ought to be in church in the final days of history. We see fussing and fighting in the church and don't see unity and harmony in the church. We see people trying to be lone rangers and go do their own thing. Listen, we need one another. I need your encouragement. You need my encouragement. I need to pat you on the back. You need to hug me around the neck. We need to help one another. We need to work together. Satan is not only a deceiver and a destroyer, he's a divider. When you see squabbling and fighting in the house of God, you'll see the devil if you look real close. Lastly, we're talking about if we believe the promise that Jesus made is going to happen, and it is. If we believe it's going to happen sooner than later, perhaps even in our lifetime, we better be saved. Today's the day of salvation. Now's the accepted time because he may not come back tomorrow. He might come today. We need to encourage one another. Lastly, we need to live holy lives. You don't hear this much from the pulpits anymore either. Seems like the philosophy of most churches is, how low can we go? How many beers can I drink and still be holy? How many bottles of whiskey can I drink and still be holy? How many pages of pornography can I look at before I'm not considered holy? How much reefer can I smoke and still be holy? How much can I steal from my boss and still be holy? How much can I cheat on my spouse and still be holy? How much can I abuse my children? How much can I lag out of church? How low can I take the bar and still be a Christian? That's the message of the modern church. We're going to set the bar so low that you can go out there and do anything you want to do and still claim you're a Christian and go to heaven. Isaiah, in closing, one of the great prophets of old, he got a chance to see the heavens opened. He saw God the Father. Maybe the only man who's ever seen God the Father. He saw God the Son. He saw God the Spirit. And this great prophet who wrote the book of Isaiah, one of the greatest prophets of all time, in God's Hall of Fame, an all-star, if you will, when he saw the Father and the Son and the Spirit, for that brief moment when he saw them, you know what he said? Grace, grace, grace. Mercy, mercy, mercy. Love, love, love. Good, good, good. No. He said the only thing any of us could ever say if we saw him. Holy, holy, holy. God the Father is holy. God the Son's holy. God the Spirit's holy. And those who walk with them will be holy because they are holy. The Bible says in the last days they would have a form of godliness but nigh the power that is in. You know what the power is? It's the Spirit of God. And you know what the power of the Spirit of God does to a Christian who's real? He makes him holy. Makes us like Jesus, and Jesus is holy. Ladies and gentlemen, he's coming again. Are we ready? Heads are bowed and eyes are closed.